So, in the past 2 years, I've done a bunch of experiments with mercury and its salts, and these experiments produced a bunch of toxic mercury waste, which I now have to take care of. Mercury is extremely toxic, in fact on the screen you should be seeing the average lethal dose for mercury and its salts, and thus it can't be pulled down the drain or dumped into the environment, because first, that's illegal, and second, you can directly poison many people. So I stored the mercury waste in these two plastic bottles. Let's recycle them. First, to separate the mercury water from the soiled stuff like the pipettes and the filter papers, I've put the whole thing through a metal sieve. I've had to be really careful here as to not spill any mercury water. The water that came over is milky white, and that's due to an unknown white precipitate which has been haunting my nightmares ever since my first experiment with mercury fulminate. As annoying as this is, I can ignore the white precipitate for now, as there will be copious amounts of aluminum salts present in the final step anyway. The best way to get the mercury out of this is to convert it into insoluble mercuric sulfide, and then recycle it chemically, nilered style. First, I tested the mercury water with a pH paper, and it came out to be strongly acidic. That's due to some nitric acid being present in it. To proceed, I'll have to neutralize the acid using a base. However, I cannot use a strong base like sodium hydroxide for this, because if I did, then I could push the pH of the solution straight to alkaline. That would precipitate mercury hydroxides, which is something I really, really don't want. That's why I've used calcium carbonate. Even though it neutralizes the acid, it doesn't dissolve into water, which doesn't tinker with the pH of the solution. For some reason, it kind of looks like Gatorade now. Still though, I'd rather drink blue mercury water than that mouthwash tear drink crime. Anyway, my schizophrenic tangent aside, once all the acid has been neutralized, I've prepared a yellow sodium sulfide solution, and I've added it all into the beaker. Once the sodium sulfide has been added, a bunch of mercuric sulfide, also known as cinnabar, precipitated. Cinnabar has two forms, the alpha form and the beta form. Here it's in the black beta form, as I've just crushed it out from the solution. Naturally occurring cinnabar is in the red alpha form, due to a different process of formation of the mercuric sulfide. If I were to use the sodium sulfide with dust present, then it would get hydrolyzed into hydrogen sulfide, which is a gas that is more toxic than hydrogen cyanide. And trust me when I say this, it smells like shit! And it gives you a headache if you inhale trace amounts of it. Anyway, now to get out the mercury salt, I vacuum filter the muddy solution. Mercury sulfide is a relatively harmless mercury salt, because it is insoluble in water, which means if you were to get it on your skin, it wouldn't be able to go through it and into your system. For that reason, it was also used as a red pigment in ancient times, and to be honest, it has a really nice red color, especially when it's milled. Eventually, we're left with mercury sulfide mud, and now we can start pulling out all the mercury from it. To do that, I first have to make a polysulfide bath. Into a beaker, I've added 40 grams of sodium hydroxide followed by 6 grams of sulfur, and I've waterboarded the mix with water. When sodium hydroxide dissolves into water, it releases heat, which will propagate the reaction between sodium hydroxide and sulfur. In this reaction, sodium hydroxide and sulfur react to form sodium sulfide, and many other polysulfides. Mercury sulfide forms a water-soluble complex with sodium sulfide, and we can use that complex to leach the mercury from the solution. Then I've added all the mercuric sulfide mud into the solution, and immediately it turns this dense black color. Now to crush out the mercury, I just have to add some aluminum foil, and I've begun by adding just a sliver of it. Immediately, an intense reaction happens where the aluminum is ripped to shreds by the sodium hydroxide and the sulfide complex. As the major reaction here, the mercuric sulfide complex reacts with the aluminum metal to form mercury metal, sodium aluminate and sodium sulfide. Once the mercury complex is exhausted, the next major reaction is the sodium hydroxide reacting with the aluminum metal to form sodium aluminate and hydrogen gas. The reaction is extremely exothermic. The water immediately turns into steam on contact with the aluminum. It got so bad in fact that when I put the beaker with the mixture outside, condensed water was dripping from my fume hood pump. In the morning, the reaction pretty much died down, so I've poured off as much water and sodium aluminate as I could. And some little mercury beads were on the bottom of the beaker. To get them out, I have simply used a glass pipette. Anyway, this is our yield of recovered mercury. Even though it looks like it's a small amount of mercury, it isn't, because the density of mercury is around 13.5 grams per milliliter. So that means that we've got like half a gram of mercury. In terms of the other bottle, I will be using a different way of mercury leaching, which is based on submerging copper metal into the suspension. And from the tests I've done, this bottle most likely has much more mercury than the first one. So stay tuned for the next episode of the Prussian Blue Show, subscribe!